is a written portrayal of God, His character, and His relationship with mankind. If we could boil the Bible down into one simple statement, that's what the Bible is. It is a written portrayal of God. It shows us God. It shows us His character and His relationship with mankind. There really are two things that spring out of this, and that is the following. Number one, we find out in the Scripture who God is. Now, there are many characteristics about God. He is holy, He is just, He is righteous. We could go on and on. His character is found in the pages of Scripture, who God is. And then secondly, we find how He interacts with His creation. We open up our Bible, and we went over this in the very first lesson of this series, and we see a God who is a creator, a creative God, a Father. He creates. And when He created mankind, the rest of the Bible shows us how He interacted with His creation. And everything from history to poetry and redemption and how He gave His life, robed Himself in flesh, gave His life to redeem that creation back to right relationship with Him. And so really this is the thesis statement, if you will, of Scripture. Now, one of the statements that I try not to say over the pulpit, and I also try not to say this statement when I'm teaching home Bible studies, and I encourage others not to say it, is something along this line. Now, I know we all know this, and then we say what we know. Or we say what we think everybody knows. But have you ever been in a service or a Bible study or a midweek lesson, and something is taught, and really, honestly, if we were to give voice to what we were thinking, we would say, I didn't know that. Or I had never seen that in the Bible. And so I try to not say something like that when I'm teaching or preaching. Now, I know we all know, because there are people that truly do not know those stories. We may know about David slinging the stone and hitting Goliath, but there are some people that Goliath is no more common to them than their next door neighbor. In fact, one of the most enjoyable Bible studies that I ever taught was to a man by the name of Brent. Brent came to our church, and I started a home Bible study with him, and he preferred to have it taught here at the church rather than in his home. And so we met in my office, and Brent would come in. And one of the things that I do when I teach home Bible studies is the first lesson, I actually don't bring any Bible study with me. I don't bring a chart. I bring my Bible, but I don't bring a chart or a booklet or anything, because I want that first Bible study to be an informative time when I find out things like, tell me about your faith background. Do you know what the Bible is? Just finding out for knowledge's sake. If I say to you, turn to the book of Matthew in your Bible, do you know where that's at? Now, that's not like a quiz to make people feel uncomfortable, but in order to teach an appropriate or effective home Bible study, I need to know. I don't want to speak in a way that infers they know what the Scriptures are when they don't. And Brent was one of my most enjoyable home Bible studies because Brent knew almost nothing about the Bible. Now, that's not meant to put him down. But he was like a sponge. He was just open. And we really began to drill down on some of the themes of the Bible. And I even shared with him the thesis statement that I shared with you earlier that I had put together, that the Bible is a written portrayal of God, His character, and His relationship with mankind. In fact, I was teaching Brent, and we got to the subject of water baptism. And he said, so do you mean to tell me that when someone is water baptized, they actually go down in water? And now some of us may go, well, that's obvious. Well, to Brent, it wasn't. And so I'm sitting in my office about, what is that, 25, 30 feet down the hallway there, and it dawns on me. I'm about 35 or 40 feet from a baptistry. So I said, Brent, time out. Come with me. So I brought him over here to this baptistry, and we sat on the steps of this baptistry and taught the lesson about water baptism. And I began to teach him about water baptism. I said, now when you're baptized, right here is where I put you down in the water, and I'd bring you right back up. And so it was an enjoyable Bible study. And by the way, he was water baptized. He saw his need of that and was water baptized. But I think it's important for us to not assume that everybody knows everything or even knows the basic stories about Scripture. Now, let's dive in tonight. There are two key groups of people, and we're going to get to looking at Scripture here in just a moment. But there are two key groups of people to whom God has shown himself in the Bible. Two key groups of people. The first are the Jews. Everybody say the Jews. Now, in order to understand the Bible, we cannot miss this. Because the first two-thirds of our Bible, the Old Covenant or the Old Testament, primarily is God's interaction with the Jewish people. Someone asked me one time, well, why did God choose the Jews? And here's how I answer that. Because God had to choose somebody for two things to happen. For him to show how he interacts with people and a group of people from which the Messiah would come. Because he had in his mind from the beginning of time redemption and redemption's plan. And so that had to come from some group of people. And then also the Jews showed the world how God treats people and how God interacts with his children. So the Jews are a key group. The second key group that is found in Scripture is the New Testament church. The New Testament church. So if you can look at it like this with me, from the book of Genesis all the way through Genesis, all the way through Malachi in the Old Testament, and then Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, primarily, with a few exceptions, that part of the Bible is God's dealings with Jewish people. Now, Jesus in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, did have some dealings with Gentile people, but primarily it was Jewish people. From the book of Acts chapter 10 and going forward, the key group that is focused on, yes, is Jews, but it is now the New Testament church. And we will find that primarily the New Testament church was made up of both Jews and Gentiles. And so the reason why I share this is because it helps us get a little bit of context into how the Bible is laid out and what it means. Now, primarily up through the second half of Pastor Larry's lesson last week, God's interaction was toward the Jews up until the second half of his lesson last week. And then he talked about Acts chapter 10 and Cornelius's house and salvation coming to Cornelius, Acts chapter 10, and the Gentiles are opened up then to salvation. So with that in mind, I'd like you to turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter number 11. The book of Romans, chapter 11, and they can go ahead and put chart number 1 of lesson 11 on the screen if they would, please. Romans, chapter number 11. And we're going to look at several verses of Scripture, so keep your Bible close if you would. Romans, chapter 11 and verse 25, "For I do not desire," Paul writes to the brethren, "that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. As it is written, the deliverer will come out of Zion, and he will turn away ungodliness from Jacob, for this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins." Now, what we're going to find in this portion of the Bible is the Jews have had Jesus pointed to them for hundreds and hundreds of years. Every prophet, every feast, every thing they went through under the old covenant pointed to a day when Jesus would walk on earth and he would be their Messiah. However, the Jews, according to Paul's writing, were blinded in their eyes. They could not see Jesus as Messiah. They saw him as a good man. They saw him work miracles, but they were blinded to the fact that he could be anything more than a carpenter's son. And so because of that, their capital, if you will, was destroyed. Jerusalem was destroyed. It was overrun by an army. Now you'll see this, and I know that's a little small to see up on the screen, but a man by the name of Titus, a ruler of Titus, came and destroyed Jerusalem. Luke 19 talks about this. Jesus prophesies about this, that there would come a day that due to the Jews' lack of belief in the Messiah, that not one stone would be left on top of another stone. And we really see the setup here for the Lord turning to the Gentiles and the New Testament church. Now, I want you to remember, though, that this was the blindness of an entire group of people. Now, here's the sad thing about this. Largely today, Jewish eyes are still blinded to Jesus Christ. Still blinded. I've told you the story, and I'll just rehearse it quickly. When I was in Israel many years ago, I went to the Wailing Wall, which is a holy place in Jerusalem, and Orthodox Jews stand there, rock back and forth, and pray at the Wailing Wall. They never turn their back on the wall. They back out because that's a sacred holy place. They don't want to turn their back on God. And I asked an Orthodox Jewish man one day when he backed out of the prayer area, I said, "Sir, can I ask you, what were you praying for?" This is just a few years ago. He said, "I was praying for the Messiah to come." Well, I wanted to say, and I didn't because I didn't want to be rude to him, I wanted to say, you've missed it by 2,000 years. Because blindness has affected the Jewish people, and now we, praise God, have had salvation opened up to us. I want to say this. I'm glad I see Jesus as Messiah. I'm glad I see him as Savior and see him as the Lord of all. Amen. And so the Jewish eyes are blinded, and their city of Jerusalem is destroyed. Now, when Jerusalem is destroyed, people are dispersed. And this is one of the most tragic things that happened in the history of the Jewish people. People are scattered. They're dispersed. We will see later that they, throughout their history, were brought into captivity of several ruling powers. And it wasn't until many, many years later, in fact, in the 20th century, that those Jewish people came back together as a people. It was May the 15th, 1948. Now, we have a few people here that probably remember hearing about this. You were probably very young. Let me just say that. But on May the 15th, 1948, Israel became a nation, and they came back together. Though once dispersed and dispersed for many, many years, they came back together. And many people, and I will tell you this, anytime Israel is in the news, we need to take notice of that, because the Jewish people are God's people. It's the first ones he turned to. And the Bible tells us there's going to come a day, although there's been blindness on their eyes all these years, that he is going to turn back to them and they are going to see Jesus as the Messiah. And so anytime there's something about Israel going on, you remember when President Trump changed the embassy to Jerusalem during his term. That took great import in that, and people were excited about that. And many people, when we talk about these things, begin to say, well, you know, we're living in the last days, and that means this, and this means that, and this means that. I will say this, and I'll talk a little bit about prophecy here in just a minute. Although prophecy is a fascinating study, I think it's important that we not get caught up on attaching specific events to things in Scripture. And here's the reason why. Because as technology unfolds and as culture unfolds, it's very easy for those to change. But what the Scripture does teach us prophetically is that we can understand the time in which we live. And I don't know about you, but I am realizing every single day how this thing is shaping up more and more. I'm going to say it. I've said it many times in the last few years, but I'm going to say, we're not getting ready to go in the end times, folks. We are living in the end times right now. We're living, and I'll talk more about that here in just a minute. So Jesus was Messiah for the Jews. They were blinded to that. He turned to the Gentiles. Take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37. Would you please? Ezekiel 37. They can go to chart number 2. Ezekiel chapter number 37 and verse number 21. Ezekiel is an Old Testament prophet, and here's what he says. "Then say to them, thus says the Lord God, surely I will take the children of Israel from among the nations, wherever they have gone, and will gather them from every side and bring them into their own land. And I will make them one nation in the land, on the mountains of Israel. One king shall be king over them all. They shall no longer be two nations," that speaks of the divided kingdom in the Old Testament, nor shall they ever be divided into two kingdoms again. So Ezekiel prophesies about a day when the Jewish people would come back together as one nation. May 15th, 1948, we see this beginning to take place, this coming together. And by the way, that nation is here to stay. We're going to see that as we walk through this end time. That nation is here to stay. Countries rise against it. Leaders rise against it. People make threats against Israel, but that God is going to protect the people of Israel and the nation of Israel. Now, let's talk a little bit about these times of the Gentiles, and they can go to the next chart here. In your Bible, in the book of Daniel, would you turn there in your Bible? This is a fascinating passage. Daniel chapter 2 and verse number 31. Once you're there, just look up at me so I know you're there, all right? Daniel chapter 2 and verse number 31. Have you got it? All right. Now, how many of you have ever heard about this image that Nebuchadnezzar dreamed about? Has anybody ever heard that before? Nebuchadnezzar's image. Now, this is many, many years ago. Way before you and I lived, Nebuchadnezzar was an ancient leader, a heathen leader, and the scripture says he had a dream, and in his dream, he saw this very descriptive image, a head of gold, breast and arms of silver, a belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron, and feet of iron and clay. Now that sounds almost sci-fi, doesn't it? Like this is something out of a science fiction movie. And yet he has this dream of this image, and the scripture says that Daniel, the man of God, the Jewish man of God, was asked if he could interpret this dream. And God gives him the interpretation of the dream. It's in Daniel chapter 2, and look at it with me in verse number 31. You, O king, were watching, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose splendor was excellent, stood before you, and its form was awesome. This image's head was of fine gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. And in this image, it outlines periods of time. Each one of these different parts of this image represents periods of time that God's people, the Jews, would come under the captivity of another group of people. And so you can see it on the screen there. The head of gold represents when Babylon carried away Israel, carried away the children of Israel to captivity for 70 years. Babylon was a very wealthy nation, a rich nation, and they were gold. In fact, there's a reason why that head was made of gold, because they were a very gold-rich country and a very gold-rich nation. And then the Babylonian Empire gave way to the Medo-Persian Empire, and that's where you see the breast and the arms of silver, and that gave way to the Grecian Empire, Alexander the Great, that kind of time frame, belly and thighs of brass, and then the legs of iron, which represent the Roman Empire, which was the lording over empire when Jesus walked on earth, all right? Now, we get to the bottom of the image, and it says it had feet of iron and clay. And this represents an empire that will still be forming. In fact, I will tell you, I think it is forming even as we speak right now. The revised Roman Empire. The image had feet of iron and clay. Iron and clay do not mix. They don't join naturally together. And so this part of the image represents a period of time when there would be a conglomeration or a federation, if you will, of powers that will come together and rule. And we will find in Scripture, in the book of Revelation, that there will be a 10-nation group of people that will rule with the Antichrist during the end time, a 10-nation federation, and they will rule with the Antichrist during that time, and it will be a revision or a reviving of the Roman Empire. Now, I would like you to look with me at the book of Psalms, Psalm 118 and verse 22. And it's interesting to note that the book of Psalms actually has prophetic significance. A lot of times we look at the book of Psalms and thinks it's just kind of a collection of songs and David was on the hillside encouraging himself. But there actually is a lot of messianic, if you will, or prophetic words within the book of Psalms. Psalms 118 and verse number 22. Psalm 118 and 22. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Everybody say, the stone. Now, with that in mind, hold your place there and turn into the New Testament book of Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21. So the psalmist called the Messiah a stone that the builders rejected. He's become the chief cornerstone. Matthew chapter 21 and verse number 42. Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Verse 43, "Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it. And whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but on whomever it falls, it will grind him to powder." Now, one of the things that Daniel prophesies is there, though there is this image, a stone will come, and this is the imagery that's just unique. A stone will come and break down this image and grind it down. It will fall upon it and it will grind it down. Jesus said there's a stone that the builders rejected, and that stone has become the chief cornerstone. What we find is that Jesus Christ is greater than any power on this earth. And anybody who comes to him and falls upon him will find life. But we will find in the end, after the great battle of Armageddon, there will be one God that will rule above all, and that is Jesus Christ. He will fall upon the nations. Can I just tell you something, folks? We need to stay in the church, because in the end, the church wins. Those on the side of the Lord Jesus win in the end. We're on the winning side, brothers and sisters. Amen. I'm so thankful to be aligned with the chief cornerstone tonight. Amen. The chief cornerstone. Let's go to the next chart. I want you to see some of the characteristics of the end times. When we get into the scripture that talks about the end times, the scripture says that people will have a form of godliness, but they will deny the power of that. There will be people who will eat and drink and marry and giving in marriage. And it might be said, well, that happens all the time, Brother Gaddy. That's been happening for years, and that's true. But again, we're not talking about specific events. We're talking about the spirit of the age. There will be wars and rumors of wars, and people will be distracted. In fact, Paul told Timothy, he said, "In the last days, perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of themselves rather than lovers of God. They will be heady and headstrong and disobedient to parents and unthankful and without natural affection." All of these things, according to Scripture, will be happening in the last days. And I say today, that's happening among us, folks. We can see this happening. And so we get a snapshot from Scripture of the culture of the last days. Everybody say, the culture. Amen. The culture of the last days. And so this chart right here is really proof positive that you and I are living in the last days right now. Now, I want you to look at something in your Bible. Let's skip to Revelation chapter 11, and I want to show you something that may prove a little further that we are living in the last days. Revelation chapter number 11, and I'd like you to look with me at verse number 9. This is a passage that refers to two individuals called the two witnesses. And they are preaching in the streets of Jerusalem prophetically here as it's prophesied in Revelation chapter 11. Notice the seventh verse of Revelation chapter 11. "When they finish their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit will make war against them," against the witnesses, "overcome them and kill them." Watch this next couple of verses. "And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified." So these two dead bodies are going to lay in the streets of Jerusalem. Look at the next verse. "Then those from the peoples, tribes, tongues, and nations will see their dead bodies 3.5 days and not allow their dead bodies to be put into graves. Now I have to ask you a question. Up until probably the middle of the 20th century, that verse probably made no sense to people. How could two men preach in the streets of Jerusalem, be killed, their bodies lay in the streets of Jerusalem, and every tribe, every tongue, and every nation see them lying in the streets of Jerusalem? But how many of you know, since about 1950, or a little bit before that, with this crazy thing called television, and now this huge thing called the internet, and a camera in every block, it seems like, it is entirely possible for the whole world to see two people laying in the streets of Jerusalem. So do you see how this rapidly changing world that we're in has prepared us for the end times? This is why I say we may read Revelation 11 and think, how could that ever happen? Only to realize we're living in a day when technology has provided the opportunity for that to happen. We talk about the mark of the beast, and Revelation talks about the taking of the mark of the beast in the forehead or the right hand, and we think, well, you know, 100 years ago, people would say, how could a culture ever get to the place where people would willingly line up to be identified with a number to where they would have to use it to buy and sell? I'm just going to let that sit there for just a second. I don't think I even need to teach anymore on that, folks. That technology is alive right now. Some of y'all have sent me clips that you've seen of people who, for their job, so that they could go to the vending machine, had a chip implanted in them, so all they do is wave their hand over a vending machine and out pops the Coke. Folks, that technology is alive right now. Now, I don't say that to scare us, but I say that to convince us more than ever before we're living in the last days. And hopefully what that will produce in us, and I want you to hear me right now, is not a fear or a despair. But I think there's two things we need to be doing right now. We need to be praying like never before, and we need to be reaching people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to be praying and evangelizing, praying and evangelizing. When we realize the day and the time in which we live, this is the high time to reach the world. Amen. It's an exciting time. It's a very, very exciting time. Let's talk a little bit about this catching away of the church. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. Now, I think that scripturally, there is a difference, and listen very carefully because I don't want to be misunderstood on this. I think there is a difference scripturally between what we call the rapture, which the word rapture is not in the Bible, but it does refer to a catching away of the church, where we are caught up in the air with the Lord forever to be with Him. I think there is a difference between the catching away of the church and the second coming of Christ. And I'm using those words very intentionally. Because the catching of the way of the church, you can write this, if you're taking notes, you can write down 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4. And I'll just paraphrase it quickly for you in the 16th verse. It says, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God." That's where we talk about the trumpet sounding. And the church, the Bible says, "And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up." That's where we get the catching away idea. "With the Lord in the air." So he doesn't come all the way to the earth. We're caught up to be with him in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. There is another event in Scripture that's talked about called the second coming of Christ. And I believe, my belief is that, and Scripture says, the second coming of Christ is when Jesus actually comes to earth. And he sets his feet down on the Mount of Olives, the same mount that he ascended from in the book of Acts, where he ascends into heaven and the angels say, "Why are you standing here looking into heaven?" This same Jesus, have you heard this passage before? "That you saw go into heaven shall come again in like manner." What is the angel saying? There's going to come a day, Jesus is going to come and set his feet back down on that mountain. Now, I know I'm going fast through this, But I think that we need to understand the distinction in Scripture between the catching away of the church, the rapture of the church, which I'm looking forward to that day, and then later, the second coming of Christ. Now, full disclosure, this is where some people get in a little bit of, not argument, I don't think we need to do that, but a little bit of disagreement from time to time as to when all this happens. You may have heard, and if you haven't, let me tell you, there are people that believe in a pre-tribulation rapture of the church. The belief of pre-tribulation rapture means that Jesus is going to catch his church away, and then the tribulation, the 7 years of tribulation are going to happen, which will be horrific according to Scripture, especially the last half of that seven-year period. Then there are people that believe in what's called a mid-tribulation rapture, which means that seven-year final period, first half will start, 3.5 years, and then the church will be raptured, and then the last 3.5 years will happen of the tribulation. And really, we're going to find in Scripture that the last half of that seven-year period is the time when a lot of judgment is poured out. And then there are some that believe in what's called a post-tribulation rapture. Are you with me? People who believe in a post-tribulation rapture believe that the church is going to go through the entire 7 years of tribulation, and then the Lord is going to catch his church away. Okay? Now, I have friends. I'm a pre-tribulation rapture person. I think the Scripture teaches that. But I have friends, close friends, that are post-tribulation rapture people. And we get along great. We disagree on that, but we get along great. In fact, I had a text war with one of my post-trib buddies a few weeks ago. Not in a bad sort of way, but we were just throwing verses back and forth. And I asked him, I said, and by the way, if you are post-trib, I don't have any angst against you tonight at all. I just see from Scripture a pre-tribulation rapture, that there's going to be a catching away of the church, and I'll show you from the Scripture here why I believe this, and then the Antichrist will be revealed and the tribulation period will begin. But I heard one guy say he's not pre-trib, he's not mid-trib, and he's not post-trib, he's pan-trib. He thinks it'll all pan out in the end. And then I heard someone else say that all the post-trib people, if pre-trib really happens and the church is caught up before the tribulation, a lot of people are going to change their feeling right then. So we don't have to go through all that tribulation. But this is what I believe. And so I have to be accountable for what I'm seeing in Scripture. And I think we all have to just kind of study that out for ourselves. 1 Thessalonians 4, and I referenced this. You can look at this in your Bible. 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse number 16. Let me just read it so we can see it in Scripture. I think it's always good to kind of chew on it and let it be a part of who we are. So let me turn there in the Bible. And if you want to turn there, you can. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And verse number 15. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. And by the way, I'm glad that Paul wrote the next verse. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. The rapture of the church should be a comforting thing for the church. Amen. Now, I want you to look at the next book, 2 Thessalonians, chapter number 2. And I'd like you to look at verse number 7, because Paul is teaching here about the Antichrist, and he calls him the lawless one. And here's what the Scripture says, 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 7. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Now stop for just a minute and think about that. Paul said 2,000 years ago, the environment of the Antichrist is already at work. The lawlessness, the spirit of lawlessness, it's already at work. And I'll say tonight, the spirit of the Antichrist is already at work in the world today, this lawless spirit. Look at the next part. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Verse 8, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The scripture says there is a restraining force that is keeping the lawless one from being revealed. I just read that in scripture. Did you see that? There is a restraining power and a restraining force. And when that restraining power or force is taken out of the way, then the lawless one will be revealed. This is why I really believe from Scripture that this is the indwelling Holy Spirit of God in His church. Because we know the work of the Holy Spirit in the world today is for redemption's sake, to draw people to Him. But when that redemptive period of time is over, guess what's going to happen according to the Bible? The Lord's going to catch His church away. And so we as the church indwelled by the Holy Spirit, think about this with me. I believe scripturally that indwelling Holy Spirit is holding at bay the Antichrist right now. Listen, church, as bad as it is in the world right now, guess what's holding it all back right now? The church indwelled by the Holy Spirit. Amen. And there's coming a day when that church is going to be caught away, when that spirit, that redemptive draw of the Holy Spirit is going to be caught away. And so when that happens, I think scripturally we see that the Antichrist personally is revealed and the spirit of lawlessness takes over in the world. And some may say, well, my goodness, Pastor, that's happening right now. It's going to get worse. Amen. It's going to get worse. Everybody okay? Look at your neighbor and say, I think we're getting it. All right, I want to finish with this. Go to chart number 1 of lesson 12, and I want to show you this. Daniel, we talked about him interpreting the dream of Nebuchadnezzar and the different occupying powers, Babylon and the Medo-Persian Empire and the Grecian Empire, Roman Empire. Daniel was always getting really neat stuff from God. He really was. One of the things that Daniel received is in Daniel chapter 9. If you have your Bible, just turn back to Daniel. I want you to see this. Daniel chapter 9 and verse number 24. Is everybody doing okay right now? I don't think I've said this in a long time. Can you give me 10 minutes and I'm going to be done? Is everybody okay? Can you give me 10? Everybody tracking with me tonight? Okay. Daniel chapter 9. Some of you are going, turn the clock on, baby. We want to get him on the clock. Watch what Daniel gets from the Lord. Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks are determined for your people and for your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the Most High. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again in the wall, even in troublesome time. And after the 62 weeks, Messiah shall be cut off, but not for himself. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end of it shall be with a flood. Until the end of the war, desolations are determined. One more verse, 27. Then he will confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifices and offering. And on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even until the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. Daniel gets this prophecy called 70 weeks. Now, this is just fabulous. Stay with me. In fact, let me make sure we're on the right chart here. Yes, it's down at the bottom here. He says there's a period of time, 7 weeks, 62 weeks. 7 plus 62 equals 69. It's a bright congregation tonight. But his prophecy is for 70 weeks. What we're going to find in Scripture is when Daniel gets this prophecy, he is referring to, we think week as in Sunday to Saturday. But he is referring to a period of seven, a period of seven. And when you study this in Scripture, for instance, let me just give you an example. In Scripture, 7 weeks to the Jewish people was a period of seven-year periods, or 49 years. The Jewish people had the year of Jubilee, which was the 50th year. But seven was a very significant number in Scripture. And so 70 weeks is actually 70 seven-year periods. Are you with me so far? Just stay with me. I know that, this gets a little bit intense, but stay with me as the scripture folds this out. And the reason why we know that it is 77-year periods is because what the scripture says. This period of time Daniel gets from the Lord starts with the rebuilding of Jerusalem, Zerubbabel, Nehemiah, the rebuilding of Jerusalem, and goes all the way up until Messiah is crucified. I didn't make that up. That's right in the passage that we just read. Now, do you know how long that period of time is? It is 69 parts that are times 7. That many years, all right? All the way up. 69 times 7, that number of years is a period of time from the rebuilding of Jerusalem all the way until Jesus died on the cross. But the issue we still have is there's another 7-year period that was prophesied, the 70th week. So we have to ask ourselves, when does that happen? I want you to notice up on the screen something that's really interesting. And maybe what we'll do after this Bible study, we'll leave BJ this up here because this helps make a lot of sense of where we are. Remember, Daniel's prophecy is concerning the Jewish people. So we have all these years, 69 times 7, all these years from the rebuilding of the walls and Jerusalem all the way to Jesus Christ dying on the cross. And then you fast forward, you jump over a period of time, and we see a 7-year period of time that we know from Scripture as the Great Tribulation, when according to the Bible, that Antichrist will make a covenant with Israel. Do you know when that happens? In the middle of that 7-year period. And then he breaks that covenant, and he pours out his wrath on the Jewish people. So the question might be asked, well, Pastor, we got the whole thing about from the rebuilding of Jerusalem till Jesus dies. What about that 2,000-year period before the tribulation starts? This is what the scripture teaches is the church age. This was the, can I say it like this? The parenthetical age that Daniel did not see. But we see it borne out in Scripture when the church comes on the scene. And then, here's what's great. When the church is taken out of the way, the last week comes to pass. Now, did you see that right there? Did you catch that? So we have this plan that the Lord spells out in Scripture of dealing with how God deals with the Jewish people. Then we see the church age that you and I are in that's wrapping up, by the way. And the church is raptured and the 7-year tribulation begins. Okay. Now, I'll leave this up here because this is a really powerful thing. In fact, I have to tell you, whenever we have new ministers come before our district board, many of them, if they're young ministers, are just so nervous. And they're just shaking in their boots. Not because we're going to be mean to them. They don't want to mess up anything. And I will try to really calm them down by saying, now, brother, all I'm going to ask you to do is give us a full detailed description of Daniel's 70 weeks. So I've actually used this in a joking way as though it's this very complex thing. But here's the thing, brothers and sisters. When you and I start drilling down on Scripture and we start seeing this historically, how God has dealt with the Jewish people and then how he's going to deal with them during the tribulation and where we fit in this, it is like light bulbs go off in your brain. That we're living in the church age right now. We're living in this wonderful age of God's Spirit being poured out on us. Aren't you glad to be alive today? Yeah. Oh, I'm so thankful to be alive today. Amen. It's a great day to be living. Amen. Now, let me quickly come to a close. Chart 4 of lesson chapter 12. And I just want to point this out and we'll be finished. Chart 4 of lesson 12. Armageddon. You've heard this before, the Battle of Armageddon. What is the Battle of Armageddon? My wife and I, about 2 years ago, I think it was, were in Israel, and we actually went to the Hill of Megiddo. And the Hill of Megiddo, if you look up Armageddon and you see what it means the Hill of Megiddo. So we were actually standing on the Hill of Megiddo, and we were looking out over this large plain, which is where Scripture says the Battle of Armageddon will take place, all right? Now, we may look and say, who's going to be fighting in the Battle of Armageddon? I've heard a lot about that the blood's going to go all the way to the horse's bridle, and it's going to be a total annihilation of the enemies of God, and it will be. What we see in Scripture that will be happening is there will be two very different combatants. The first one will be Jesus Christ. And by the way, the Scripture teaches, and I'm just going to share this with you, and you can study this out when you get home. The Scripture teaches that a group of people will be coming with him when he sets his feet on the Mount of Olives, and that group of people will be the church that he has redeemed. We're going to come with him, and we will fight, and he will lead the charge in the battle against every enemy of Jesus Christ, and specifically every enemy of the nation of Israel. Nations are going to rise. They're going to coalesce together. The Antichrist will lead the charge. But what we will find is that the Battle of Armageddon will be decisively won by Jesus Christ. Scripture teaches that. And so this is going to be a horrific time, but it's going to be a very decisive win for Jesus Christ. Now, this ought to excite us because we're on the winning side, folks. I say it again, as long as we stay with Jesus, we're on the winning side. Amen. The next slide, and this will be the last one, speaks of something called the Great White Throne Judgment. I want to point out two things about the judgment because this can sometimes get misconstrued. The Bible teaches two types of judgment seats, all right? If you're taking notes, just jot this down. You can study this out when you get home. The first is called the judgment seat of Christ. Everybody say the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ. This is actually, you can jot it down, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10 says that the redeemed, the saved, will come before the judgment seat of Christ to be judged for what they did in their bodies. This is when rewards will be passed out. You heard people talk about, I'm going to get a crown. Well, right there is when you're going to get your crown. And so Paul gives indication about the judgment seat of Christ. The judgment seat of Christ is not a judgment seat where people are sent to hell. We are judged for what we have done for the Lord. And by the way, I don't want to waste my time and not do things for the Lord. I don't want to be just a bystander waiting until the pearly gates open so I can walk on in. I want to be about my Father's business. I want to be reaching people. I want to be discipling people. I want to be found faithful. Amen. And it's at the judgment seat of Christ, 2 Corinthians 5, that we will receive that which we have done in our bodies. All right? And I want to be found faithful at that time. Also in Scripture is the Great White Throne Judgment. This is in the next to last chapter in the Bible, Revelation chapter 20, where all those who have died and who have not been judged come before the Great White Throne Judgment. And this is the judgment, according to Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15, where the Lord sits on the throne, and the Bible says the books are open, including the book of life. And if your name is found in the book of life, remember this is the dead who are judged at this time, you enter into the joy of the Lord. If your name is not found in the book of life, you are sent to everlasting damnation, okay? So I think it's important that we understand. It's easy sometimes to just throw terms around. Rapture, second coming of Christ, judgment seat of Christ, second great white throne judgment. But they're very unique in their own understanding. In the last lesson of this, and I won't get into this tonight, but in the last lesson of this, the Bible says there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And this is a glorious picture in the book of Revelation chapter 21 of this new heaven. And the Scripture says, almost in the last few verses of Scripture, that in that day, the Lord will wipe away every tear. There will be no more death, no more pain, no more sickness. Oh, I'm looking forward to that. He will make all things new. I want to be on that side. Amen. Would you stand with me? I may have gone over by 2 minutes. But I'm going by metric, so I got one more. Just kidding. I want to say this to the church, and I talked to some of our leaders about this last night. I really believe that God is calling us in 2021 to living according to the kingdom of God. He's calling us to prayer, and he's calling us to personally be involved in the kingdom. So I want to appeal to every person that has ever desired to reach someone with the gospel. And I want to say to you, I want you to hear your pastor say this. You can teach a home Bible study. You can. You don't have to be the Bible answer man or woman to teach a home Bible study. You can teach a home Bible study. Now, you don't have to teach it all in 6 weeks like we've done. You can stretch it out. I taught a family one time, and it went for 2.5 years. That's like the Bible in 2.5 years, okay? But you can, when we personally invest in people, James Lumpkin Sr., one of the dear elders in my life, said this, Tim, the kingdom of God is one soul at a time. So let me say to you, if you have any desire to help people get to heaven, please let me know that. Come and talk to me. Come and talk to Selinda. Come and talk to John, one of our other staff. We want to help you get mobilized to sit across the table and teach people the scriptures. There is power in the Word of God. There's power when it's taught. Amen. You might teach someone like Brent, who's brand new, open, and God will do great things. Let's pray right now. Just ask the Lord to seal this in our spirit. God, thank you for this evening. Thank you for this study. We're doing our best, Lord, to teach the church and to get us all mobilized and ready, God, to be great Christians and walking with you. And I pray that this will be more than information, but this will be motivation, Lord, to all of us to be ready, to pray, to reach people, I pray, in the last days. You've got your hand on your church, and I'm thankful for it, Lord. Be with us. Keep us in the days to come, Lord. Keep us strong in the faith, Lord. And we praise you. We're glad we're in the church, Lord. We commit it all to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let somebody know on your way out what you learned tonight, something that resonated with you. Would you do that? Let them know what you learned. God bless you. If I can meet just quickly with those that are about the Spanish ministry, if you want to make your way up here, we'll talk just briefly.
Reason for it.